Hey, legends, welcome back to the Mason Cox Show. As you can imagine, an insane week in football. To start off, Gil had an apology, which we all knew was going to come. We also had two Tigers last hurrah, absolute legends of the club, played their final game. And of course, that Friday night battle, 1-2, Collingwood versus Brisbane. So massive, massive podcast coming up. So settle in. Let's get into it. All right, legends, let's get into it. Welcome, Braden.
Oh, Mason, don't be like that. Now, I know you've got some big news for us off the top that you want to just, you know,
dive straight into.
Dive straight in. Lather us up. We've got some good news for you.
We are going to Beyond the Valley. I hear there's a little festival here in Australia around New Year's time that all the kiddos love to go to. There's a few doof sticks, you know, the old Matt Preston was on a doof stick, and someone sent me and myself, I think, on a doof stick last year. So I'm not sure if we're going to come with our own doof stick, but I feel like that should be our one thing we should go to Beyond the Valley with, surely.
Now, I didn't know that it was a music festival, mate. So I thought you were asking me on a Lord of the Rings style adventure Beyond the Valley. But I am very excited to be a part of it. And I'm actually starting to shit myself because
great.
More and more people are like, oh, my God, I'll be at Beyond the Valley. I'll see you at Beyond the Valley. And I'm like, oh, geez. This is going to be concerning if a lot of people show up, mate.
I don't think a lot of people know that you've never done anything publicly in front of people. So I'm excited to see exactly how you respond, Braden.
I'm excited to see how I respond. If there's alcohol at these things, right? Maybe a couple of, you know, bits of courage to fill me up. And there is women at these events too, mate.
Yes, Braden.
I've got one eye on the crowd. See how we go.
Can you imagine telling that story at your wedding? Oh, where'd you meet? Beyond the Valley. Said, did you check out the podcast stage? Your boy was on there.
Yes,
that's exactly how I see it going
lead
down.
With, I was on the podcast stage, man. So that's a pretty big deal.
It is. Well, before we go too far into your future misses, we'll get into the podcast. Oh. There's a lot to cover here today. And we'll start off with the clangers of the week. What do you got for us?
And this was one of those weeks where we really had to shortlist it down from about 20 clangers that happened over this weekend because, geez, they're ramping it up. It's like, you know, some of the officials are getting into finals mode as well. So they're all ramping it up as well. But I will jump into mine, which is the West Coast Eagles.
Oh, God.
Now, it's probably the only time as a fan that you're sitting there as your team's taking the lead and you're going, what are you doing?
What are you doing, dude? We've been practicing all year for this.
We've worked hard for this moment and you're stuffing it up. Now, I get you want to win. Everyone wants to win and it's all well and good. But, you know, number one draft pick is also something to be very happy about. You can have your moment in the sun after the season is finished. But West Coast are really trying to fumble the bag. They got one game left to see how much they can lose by. But if they don't, I had flashbacks of the moment where Richmond won with like a kick after the siren and it set a chain of events that happened that ended up them getting dusty in the draft. But, you know, come on, just take the L, go back to Perth and get your number one draft pick.
It's interesting though. I might have saved Adam Simpson's job at the same time. So they did have something to play for, Braden. We'll get into that later in the podcast. My clanger for the week. Oh man, if anyone was watching on Friday night, this might be the biggest news that came out of it. Devin Robinson, he's got a ring. He has got a ring. His shirt came off. Prezzy ripped it off from behind him. He went full Hulk Hogan and then threw the whole thing off. He said, nah, we're going full nudity here. No, I'm kidding. Half nudity. We almost went the full Monty. But he took his shirt off, and I think the statistics said he gained 26,000 followers overnight. And I'm just saying this, if I'm Devin, I'm just starting an OnlyFans starting today. Because then you can retire. You don't have to worry about anything else. Just, you know, continue that momentum. And he's looking good. Just throwing it out there, man. I guarantee you, out of that 26,000, probably 20 of those were females.
A lot of thirsty AFL followers out there just tuning into the game. Didn't know that it was going to turn into like a bit of a foreign SBS film late at night where if all the lads out there know what I'm talking about. But yeah, I didn't think it was that good a rig. Was that that good a rig?
Yeah, it was pretty good. Not going to lie. I mean, I'm not taking my shirt off in the game. I'll tell you that, Brad. You know when the guy was running around with the new jersey? I would have been darting straight for that guy to get a new jersey ASAP.
I always like that there's TVs, right? There's high definition, standard definition, yeah. And there's zero definition. Hey. That's what I got over here. So I can't really talk.
Everyone that's listening in. We'll get into the games. There's a lot to cover here. The first one off the top, Richmond versus North Melbourne. Richmond with the win, 101-72. And the big news that we talked about off the top, Jack Riewoldt and Trent Cotchin's last game as Richmond legends, which was an amazing thing to see them sent off in a beautiful style and very emotional before the game, as you'd imagine. But I had this thought, right? So I thought back to Hawthorn, and you had Jared Roughead playing someone in his last game, right? And I think he kicked like a bag, and it was like anything that was beyond halfway down the field was going to him inside 50. Like, surely you do this with Jack and Trent in the last game. Like, the game's done. You're not making finals. You're playing North Melbourne. They're at the bottom of the ladder. Like, surely that's the goal of this whole experience, is it?
I think the only difference is, small difference, minute. They kind of did that, but Jack Riewoldt was kicking absolute sacks, Jared Roughead was putting him through from anywhere.
He was actually slotting from what? Yeah, he was just like turning on a dime, just snapping.
He was kicking
over his
a snap on the run and did like the Titanic slow motion run. Yeah, Jack Riewoldt's first shot at goal, which was like one of the first, if not the first, for the game. He just nicked one of his shoelaces, I reckon, on the way through, and it went about 20 meters to the just ahead and to the far left, and it was like, it's going to be a long day if you keep kicking him like that.
He could unretire for a game and fix that and go for one more.
There was a moment in this game, I don't know if you saw it, Jack Zeebel took an absolute hanger.
Yes.
And they're like, oh, he's still got it. Get him a contract.
Get him a contract.
And he looked inside and tried to pick off a kick into the middle. Mm. Direct turnover, straight to a goal for the opposition.
We don't remember that. I just remember the specky, Brady.
It's like that so quick that it was like, maybe I still got this, he's thinking as he's running back on the mark, and then direct turnover, and you're like, yeah, good last game.
Yeah, good last game. You know, I made my mark. Dustin Martin had an amazing game, turned back the clock. Shai Bolton kicked four. But we got to get back to this. Nick Larkey, we've talked about this man a few times. Sue kicked six. On the day, he is the Oscar Allen of North Melbourne.
He's still only just getting started, too. Like, he's got plenty of years left ahead of him. Big lad, like big unit, big can still move. Like, yeah, he's had an incredible season for especially where North are. Yeah. And as you mentioned, Oscar Allen, we pretty much give him a shout out every week.
North, as we mentioned every single week, we got to do this again. Hey, they were in it for a decent shot. They're competitive. They're up 14 points 10 minutes into the second term. And it's only a 9-point difference going into the fourth quarter. Richmond rolled them in the end. But like we said many times, you know, it's good signs for North Melbourne. It's good signs. We have a bit of positivity with them, right? A bit of positivity.
Okay.
And who they got next week again?
It doesn't matter.
They're going down to the old home ground down there in Tasmania.
Which is bullshit. If you think
playing Gold Coast, I think.
Gold Coast versus North in Tassie. Last game of the year, nothing I'd forfeit. If I was Gold Coast, I'd be forfeiting that game. What's the point? Why send us down there? It was the cruelest fixture. At the start of the year, you're not doing the fixture and going like, geez, I reckon if we put North Gold Coast, it might be for a top four spot. Let's chuck that down and no, it was dumb. Whoever's doing it has like beef with one of these teams. Like there's no way.
Maybe
that
you're just trying to drum up the Tassie, you know, like experience. They didn't know if Tassie was going to get a team or not. Maybe this is their last chance to be really, you know, get the crowd going down there.
Oh, imagine
maybe
that.
A selling point.
We will touch on it. Dimma said, I won't start for 2 weeks. Now I know why. He's like, I'm not going down
he's
to,
not
Tassie.
Going to Tassie. He's like, boys, I just went to the Gold Coast for good weather, not to go to Tasmania. Well, speaking of Dimma, we're going to the next game. Suns versus Carlton. You would have probably gone into this game thinking Carlton's, what, won 8 or 9 on the trot. Probably going to roll the Suns who are not making finals. But it was a really good game. Might be the second best game of the round, I'd say.
Carlton fans would have been sweating. Carlton looked completely off it, like at the start. And I don't know if part of it is, you know, they're used to like playing at the G or in Melbourne with a massive following, and they just really ride that wave of momentum. They had none of it in the Gold Coast. It was a day game, off Broadway. Like, their fans rolled in, but definitely nowhere near
an MCG
experience. And Gold Coast was all over them early, and it was all Gold Coast pressure. Like, they were manic. And, like, Carlton had, like, nowhere to go, no breathing room, and I don't know. It didn't look good early.
For the Suns, David Swallow kicked a career-high 4 goals. Tuukka Miller had 29 disposals, and Jared Woods had 38 hit-outs, so those were the big ones. But you talked about the momentum shift in that third quarter. Suns had 25 turnovers, and that's whenever the Carlton Blues essentially said, boys, we're taking over here. We're going to win this game, and we're going to lock in a final spot, which they did. And, they're officially playing finals, and the lid almost got put back on Carlton, but it's still off, baby. It's still off. The lids are well and truly off, as everyone's been saying.
It did cook that last game. The last game of the year would have been Carlton v GWS to make finals, which would have been an exhilarating game, but they took that away from us. Charlie and Harry playing together again. Harry, fair to say, he didn't do too much, but he was coming back into the team, coming back from injury, so you don't expect a massive one from him. He did kick a goal, but it was Charlie that got it to him over the top. Charlie, however, looked scary good, like scary good. And you can finally see him playing in finals, like where he belongs. This guy's like a...
He's a box office. He's a ticket seller.
Yeah.
For sure.
And you could see at one moment where they needed him most, took a mark outside 50, wheeled around and just smashed it home. And it was like... Yeah, to see him do that at somewhere like the MCG in finals is going to be pretty scary good.
And he kicked 5 on the day, so we crown, right? You put the king on, I think that's Charlie's one. And I want to also shout this out because not only was he good in the forward half, at the very end of the game, he got put into defense and actually took the mark in D50 that probably sealed the game for Carlton, gave him the win, which is super impressive. He now sits 8 clear of Tex Walker. Tex Walker Ranger. I can't not laugh whenever I hear the name. Essentially, Carlton's now going into playing finals. They're locked in. Cripps did go down to the rooms, I think, in the first quarter.
And he came back out
and played, though. So
but he had,
right.
I noticed that he had one of those massive rib guards on. You know where they try to hide it to be like, I don't have smashed up ribs.
This is what I love, though, because we get this break before finals, right? And I think this allows all these teams to have a little bit of, issues here and there, maybe their body's a bit sore, whatever it is, to really kind of get fresh to show the best of the best whenever it comes to finals. So Carlton's on the 9-game winning streak, and it'll be interesting to see them finally playing finals. And they're going to be a threat. There is no doubt about that. In form at the right time of year. Now, the next game we're going to, you'd be super stoked about this game. Your boys.
I am sitting here pretty proud of my boys getting the job done. GWS absolutely pile driving Essendon into the dirt. This was, I feel like I'm just going to reel back in when I was like, Essendon has had a successful year because I don't know anymore.
I mean, the score is 162-36. Whenever that came up and I was looking at the scores, I was like, is this incorrect? Like, someone screwed up the scoreboard. I was kind of confused by it. Jesse Hogan kicks 9.
And they were trying to get him 10.
Career best. 9. That hurts deep, deep down. Oh, I would be filthy if I was him right now going, I was 1 goal away after having an absolute blinder of a day from getting 10 goals for a career high.
He was limping. He was like in everything. He had a shot with a minute left, just outside the goal square while being tackled and missed his boot. So close. But he said he'd never been near 10 before. So, it was a massive effort. And, they've still got stuff to play for. Essendon, on the other hand, boy, oh boy, where are we? When you're playing and you can see them trying to get one of their teammates 10 goals and they're subbing out Toby Green to just chill on the bench to rest up. And it's like... Surely you're sitting out there going like, oh my God, we're non-competitive at this point in time.
Oh, it was interesting. I mean, Bombers still a mathematical chance is what I've been told.
I think they have to beat you by 160 or something.
Oh, wow.
Doable. Because they
done here on the day. I mean, look at this. But Jesse Hogan, maybe prayers up to you for not making 10, bro. That's rough.
And we will say one of your favorites, Phil Davis, retired 192 games over 15 years. That's a massive career.
He is one of the absolute, you talk about good guys of footy who are just super nice, loving person, just an absolute legend. He's very well spoken, very nice fella. So Phil Davis does retire after 192 games, and I'm going to miss him out there. He's just one of those people you enjoyed. Like, he was a tough competitor, don't get me wrong, but I think he's one of those people you enjoyed talking to after the game. You know, what have you been up to, man? Like, what are you doing? You know, and he's always excited to talk to everyone, and he's just a really good fella, really good fella. So he's going to be missed in the AFL world, but I think he will have a job in media. There's no doubt about that.
He could move into a lot of things, I reckon.
Yeah. I think he'll do a bit of Channel 7 commentary, if I had to take a guess.
Every time he goes on there, he wears the very smart spectacles.
He is part of the glasses gang.
Oh, the goggle boys. The goggle boys.
The glasses gang.
Goggle gang. Goggle gang. Oh, it's not full goggles.
It's not full goggle. We'll get him one.
Well, no one wears the full goggles.
It's a one-man show.
Yeah. Let's jump into this next one. St. Kilda v. Geelong. Interesting. Geelong really running out of steam late in the season. Tried to find their winning form that saw them win a flag last year, but obviously couldn't do it. Chris Scott, no longer a Geelong the danger if they make finals, because they can't make finals at this stage. But Ross Lyon, this is the story. It's not Geelong kind of missing the eight, which is pretty
big story.
But Ross Lyon taking this St. Kilda team that not a lot of people had making finals at the start of the year, they're a top two defensive team in the league. And to win flags, you got to be good in defense.
Defense wins championships, my brother.
Ross Lyon, top two defensive team. And now they're starting to put it on the scoreboard. Mm. So they scored 88 for this game, which, you know, it's not going to blow anyone's socks off, but that's pretty good when you're as stingy as St. Kilda. They're going to, you know, rattle a few cages come finals.
They held Geelong to 55 points. I think with Geelong, like, yeah, yet Hawkins was injured a few weeks ago. I reckon some of these guys were trying to get them over the line, you know, and coming back probably before they're 100%, which you're never 100% in football, but we're really pushing to try to get their team to make it to finals, maybe get that week to, like, rest up and then be able to go again. But, Geelong officially out the premiers of last year and not making finals this year, which I'm not sure what the mathematical chances of that are, but probably not very high. And it's pretty interesting. But I want to bring to attention something that happened this game, because I was looking at, as we do on this podcast, we like to have a thing for plumbers, right? So if you get 50 taps.
Always go to the rough tap.
You go straight that's my thing, right?
Yeah.
Disposals and stuff. Who cares?
Get 30 touches.
Anyone get show me 50 hitouts. ain't many people in this world has done that. So anyway, I looked at it, and Rowan Marshall had 28 hitouts. That's good. Don't get me wrong. But the weird thing I saw whenever you clicked the hitouts thing was the next one was 6. So you're telling me between the two major ruckmen, there was 34 hitouts, and that was it. Was there any stoppages in this game, or was there 34 center bounces?
Got to get those numbers up.
I've never seen anything like that. Like, it was and then I think Hawkins had maybe 4 after that. So it wasn't like there was a ton of stoppages or ability to have hitouts, apparently. I don't know. Maybe they just kind of hugged each other and made love in the middle and let it drop and didn't touch it.
I mean, most people would love free flowing footy, but not the rucks.
Not the rucks.
They want to get those numbers up.
Yeah. And the mids don't give it to us. I mean,
but that's what I will back over it. 55. Geelong scored 55 with Hawkins, Cameron, Henry. Rowan. They've got so Stengel. Yeah. Like, they got so many forwards. It's very impressive, and they're going to
– Ollie Henry too.
I reckon they're going to do some damage out there. Now, we got to get to this game because it is the biggest talking point, and obviously could have been Clanger of the Week, Mace.
Can I preface this game before?
This is Clanger of the Year stuff. Hands down, mate.
On this podcast, right, we've gotten in trouble a few times. I'm going to let you lead this one, Braden. And if I don't say anything, you know, take it how you may.
Set the scene. If you could at least be a scene setter.
To give a bit of context to people out there, Adelaide lost this game, which therefore means they're not playing finals. So it's safe to say, big decision.
Whoopsie. Let me give it a little flavor now that you've set it up.
Give us a little salt bay here.
So Ben Keys, right, kicks a blinder.
Unreal kick, by the way.
From the corner.
Yeah.
And it goes through. It goes through so much that he's so convinced that he's off celebrating in the front row, pointing to his head. You don't do that if you think it missed, Mace. You're not trying to convince anyone.
Yep.
You think it's a goal. It is so close. But I've never seen someone with so much conviction go, like, I swear on my life that was a point and I'm not going to change my mind. Signals the point, off they run. So it's like, I don't get the point, pardon the pun, of the score review if we're not going to use it. Come up with a solution, because then you roll out Gil, who's in a sling. I don't know why Gil's in a sling. But he's like,
it's off season for him, yeah. He's getting his few, yeah. He's getting his surgeries after the year.
When a player wraps up, they get all their work done. He's already on holidays. And yeah, he's like, yeah. If we had looked at it, would have been a goal. It's like, well, tough tits, mate. It's too late. Adelaide is booking their Mad Mondays.
AFL took ownership to say they were wrong.
It doesn't matter, mate. People's excuses are like, yeah, but you know, we should have done better in the first three quarters. That's where we really lost the game or whatever. No, you put yourself in the position to win the game and you won the game and it was taken from you.
They could have won the game, but Sydney could have, if it was considered a goal, Sydney would have gone to the centre bounce and tried to get forward. So Sydney would have had an opportunity to still win. But the matter of the fact is the arc vision wasn't used when it should have been used. And I look at it now and I'm looking at the Women's World Cup at the moment, VAR, right? That thing can figure out whether or not it is a finger length over the goal line, if it's a fingernail over the goal line. Surely looking at that, we can just call up the VAR people and go, how the hell do you do this?
Give us what they've got.
Give us what they've got. There is literally a test scenario in Australia for soccer at the moment doing its job and doing it well. Surely we can just say, let's piggyback off that shit.
In all of this, Mace, we learnt one thing is if you slap the post, the snicko goes out the window. They can't use it.
Yeah.
So every defender is just going to be slapping the post when the ball's going through. So that technology is now null and void.
If you have to stop the game to make sure you get that decision correct in such a pivotal time of the game, you have to stop it. I understand the AFL wants to make the game free-flowing and wants to make it quick and wants to make it exciting. But in that moment, in the pressure of the game, whoever's running the arc needs to get down to the umpires on their mic and say, stop it for at least 5 more seconds until we can get this correct. And if it means that maybe like you can't get that exit kick, wherever it is, to Sydney and be able to get out fast, that's just the scenario and that's what it is. But in that pressure of the game, you have to be able to make sure with all due diligence that you're making the correct decision.
Yes, 100%.
We're all talking facts. Anyway, Sydney's on a 6-game winning streak.
How good are the Swannies looking?
How good are the Swannies? Bad news for them, though. Tom McCartan did get cited for 2 weeks for essentially a bump.
So they are going to challenge, which we don't know the outcome of, but I was surprised they're challenging it.
Yeah.
Watching it live, I was like, it looked like a huge bump, but it looked like a good bump. And then they showed the replay. You know that thing that you can see if you get it back?
Have we touched on that?
And it clearly showed head contact. Elect a bump, hit the head, gone. It's pretty obvious.
Interesting. We'll move on to the next game after that one. The Bulldogs versus Eagles. What the fuck?
Shit just kept getting more frustrating as the weekend went on, Max.
This weekend, I have no idea how we landed here.
Which fan was watching this game and was happy?
I don't know. I don't think anyone was happy leaving this ground. The Bulldogs lost 85-92. The Eagles have now lost the first round draft pick. The Dogs are out of finals. Adam Simpson does probably get to keep his job out of this, and now the pressure's probably on Bebo. So you can say that the Adelaide game was controversial, but then backing into this game after that, you could almost just say we've doubled down.
I just imagine that an Eagles fan and a Bulldogs fan barracking for the same thing in the crowd. The Eagles fan, they got the ball. They're like, kick it the other way. Kick it the other way. Bulldogs like, yeah, kick it up our forward line. Oh, my God.
You know what my favorite part of this game was? Adam Simpson's comments after the game.
So good.
So good.
I was telling you.
Love a bit of character.
Not great for graphics because it was full tongue in cheek. But essentially he was like, we were really trying to tank it that last 3 minutes and we just couldn't get it done. It's like, that's gold. Obviously, people in the media and fans alike saying that they were tanking the other week by not putting man behind the ball. Well, they actually put a man behind the ball in this one. They threw Oscar Allen back late. So there was a bit of a difference in there. But I really did appreciate the joke.
It was good. I like Adam Simpson.
I like personality.
The people that give personality, I need to stay in the game. And we're excited. We actually didn't really talk about it up there. Dimma's back.
Yeah.
Dimma's back. Oh, talk about personality. Dimma's back at the Suns, baby. Oh. 6-year deal. Hey, how you going? Buy the holiday house and just kick back.
Well, yeah, we may as well carve out a little section for the coaches now because obviously Adam Simpson going into this game was going to get sacked. Everyone was saying, oh, he's going to get sacked. He's going to get sacked. Obviously not your opinion, but fans and commentators alike. And then it was completely flipped on its head. Obviously, then pressure went over to Bevo. That's, you know, you put the pressure on when you're like, we're a top four list and you're not making finals. So all of that pressure. And why do you want to be a coach? Well, Dimma said he's got more, he's hungrier now than ever going up to the Suns for 6 years. They're loony. They're crazy people. I don't get, you can't come out of it and be the same as you went into it.
I think you'd have to be a little bit crazy to say, I want to wear the Gold Coast Suns polo because that thing looks disgusting.
Give me my Macca's shirt.
The old Macca's shirt. Oh, it was quite funny. It just seemed a bit weird seeing Dimma in that. But
yeah, so Dimma said that they were like, oh, are you going to take Dusty? Are you going to poach Dusty?
Mm.
Which I don't even know if it's the right move anyway, but that's neither here nor there.
Yeah.
But he was like, I think that I've got everything I need within the four walls.
Mm.
Ellipses. Pause. And then he says, for now. It's like before he just like poaches all these players.
I leave room for improvement, but I mean, I don't want to throw anyone under the bus at the moment.
I mean, I don't know. I haven't been inside the four walls. I've been living it up in France or wherever I've been, but I reckon they seem pretty good.
There you go.
Maybe he just watched the first half of the Carlton Gold Coast game and missed the second half because maybe they could go some guys that could run out four quarters.
Hey, it's going to be interesting. And hey, as a Gold Coast Suns fan, we've said this before on this, but massive Gold Coast Suns fan.
Oh, you are. Hey,
we're back. We're back, baby. Dimma's bringing us back to finals. No, he's not bringing us back to finals. Bring us two finals for the first time next year. Dimma.
So would you go on record and say that you could see them getting their best ever result next year, which would be, I think, higher than 12th.
Oh, for sure. I'm on record right now.
Big call.
At least 11. I'm saying they're making top 8 next year.
You didn't even have to say that. You had wiggle room. You could have said 11 or up.
On top 8. Go big or go home.
Oh, my God. But
last thing about this game I want to talk about, Bulldogs players walking off the field. A real, you know, deja vu about it, didn't it?
This is
deja vu to Carlton whenever they had lost a few earlier in the year.
No one really learned from that situation. Carlton fans just forgot that they were doing it, and now they're all back on the wagon. And it is, yeah, it's always sad to see it happen. And this is vile abuse, which
wild.
Well, obviously we don't condone it. We would go as far to say that we condemn it. But yeah, it was disgusting. Obviously, they're not going out there to lose.
Whenever someone berates you like that, your own supporters, it makes you feel like this, and this is not all supporters. This is just the ones that do this. It makes it feel like they're very fickle.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
well, you got no one to turn to, no one to back you up. Like, you already feel like you're in a hole. Like,
the beauty about like Collingwood supporters, and I've noticed over the last 2 years, especially, and it's not only just Collingwood supporters, I feel like people that support Collingwood just in general, even if we like lose a game, we get clapped off, you know, and they're like, that's great effort. Where like in this situation, like it was just vile behavior. And I just kind of feel like over the last 2 years, especially, that I've really seen a shift in probably fan, you know, engagement and love for the club. Like, it's really been quite incredible to see. And like, I feel like there's a lot of people that do feel like it's family now.
I think there is a lot of fickle supporters across the league that it's like, it's easy to forgive and forget if you're winning more than you're losing.
I won't say that about our supporters because I love our supporters, obviously, but I can't speak for other teams.
Nice.
Just wrap, PC it up?
Yeah, just
that's
great.
That's the right answer, nice, that, right? Yeah. Now we'll go to the next game, Melbourne versus the Hawks. Big story out of this, Clayton Oliver got tagged by the shutdown king, old Finn McGuinness.
So he can be tagged because everyone does the whole, like, you know those inside ball winning bulls that it's like, oh, why even tag him? He's still going to get 30 touches because he's in at the coal face. They always say the coal face. Who, like, anyway.
1900.
But he can be tagged by Finn McGuinness. I'm not sure that he's really back to full fitness. I won't.
Clayton Oliver,
Clayton Oliver. I won't write off what Finn did because he's been, like, shutting down some massive. He played on Nick Dacos and did a number on him. And, yeah, so he's been massive. But it was, he's broken Clayton Oliver, multiple Clayton Oliver streaks. So He was 53 games, consecutive games, with 5-plus clearances and 154 games with 15 or more touches.
Yeah.
Both out the window.
Yeah. And I think it came out to be, what, he had like 14 or something on the day, and Finn had 13. So Finn had essentially one less disposal on him. But Simon Goodman, after the game, said that, like, he's not obviously he's not trying to go for the ball, which – maybe he didn't see the stat sheet after or something. He's probably one of those comments. And he's going, "Oh, well, okay, fair call." Like, after the game, but yeah, he did a decent job on old Clayton Oliver. And there's another thing I want to bring up: Lever and May, massive in the game. Melbourne's backline elite. Yeah,
I wanted to say that it's like, you know, whenever Melbourne's been good across the journey, it's been like, "Oh, Lever and May. How do we stop Lever and May?" They've been saying it for years. How do we stop Lever and May? And no one has really figured it out. Every now and then they might have a down game, or one might get injured and it's just relying on the other. But, like, why aren't teams heavily investing in these defenders? Because you see them make massive differences to teams. Like, you got Darcy Moore, like, coming out.
Moore, Jeremy Howe is now playing the forward line, was playing the back line, versatile player.
Like, so many teams have these, like, I don't feel like they get the props they deserve. But I'm like a really good center half back or like full back now. Like, they just intercept mark and set up the whole offense. But it's still like these key forwards and mids that are getting $1 million.
Yeah. I think you need the lockdown defender. So it takes down the best forward, right? So maybe a big defender takes down the first or the biggest and best forward. And then you've got the interceptor. It just floats around, plays a little bit of whatever he wants, you know, and just kind of comes across old McGovern style. And just, you know, because you think of like Brass, McGovern, Brass, lockdown, McGovern, float across, take as many marks as you want. You look at Geelong. Geelong's got
Stewart,
who comes across. And then you have Blitz Abs, who might lock down the tall. Like, it's kind of like, I feel like the, you know, how you kind of structure a team in the defense. So you need to have those two people to offset each other to really be as successful as possible. But it is. I mean, defense wins championships, and it's such an important part of it. But, you know, we all love goals.
Times have changed so much, I reckon. Like, it's not like the back pocket plumber and, like, the lockdown, and they can have no skills and be slow and all that stuff. It's like there's no bad kicks in Collingwood's back line, and they all set up the offense. And that's where your speed comes from, whether it's like Noble or Quaynor, like streaming out of half back, puts all the pace on the game and stuff. Like, it really starts from half back, like a lot of these teams. And it's like,
Saad, you got Connor McKinnon, that's have these, like, you know, this pace to get it out of the defense, get it back.
And a good kick. And they just.
A good kick, yeah. They break lines. I want to go into the VFL for Melbourne, though, because Brody Grundy was dropped for this game. Tom McDonald was playing the VFL, kicked 3. So, there are some people in the VFL that are going to cause some headaches for Simon Goodwin going into finals as far as selection, which would be very interesting to see and how that pans out.
Bailey Fritch would be pretty close to coming back. And that's the last knock on Melbourne at the moment, is like defensively they're just shutting down teams, but they just got to get the score on the scoreboard. But at the moment they've got no forwards. Like, they got to get some of these forwards, tall forwards, in form. And yeah, it's going to be a real race to finals to see who they can get in there.
It'll be interesting to see who they are. It all kind of shakes out to be who starts on their team. But
they got Jake Melksham is like their key forward, and he's kicking threes he's and fours and stuff, but it's like, you're going to have some big pillar up there. They could probably go a Luke Jackson type.
Who knows? That's an interesting comment. We'll go to the Fremantle versus Port game. Fremantle 58, Port 74. Port essentially now obviously top four locked in. And get the win over there in Fremantle or in Perth. So Rosie, 31 and a goal. He didn't have that goal over his head. That was pretty interesting.
Yeah, it was a pretty good snap. Kid's got some talent. I will say that. And there's Tom Emmett as well for Freo. Kicked 2 on debut, which I always love. Had the old Joel Selwood head wrapped up. It's always good you just want some good photos from your first game and your head's all caved in. Yeah.
Bailey, I'd rather take the Devin Robinson look of shirt off, but that's okay.
Bailey Banfield. Now, talk about Rosie's like snap goal over his shoulder. It was good.
Yeah.
But Bailey Banfield would have kicked one of the old-timers. Now, unfortunately, the AFL came out and used the score review, which I don't know why you would.
What's that?
And it came off the defender's arm, but he went for like full Ronaldo bicycle kick spec.
Love that.
And hit it flush, went straight through the middle, but unfortunately grazed a hair or two on the defender's arm, which, you know, that party poopers. Just, I'm sick of goal umpires. Why don't they just use their intuition and just, it went through the sticks.
Let's you call essentially it a want the most entertaining solution to whatever it is.
I want
if someone
the funnest
kicks
thing.
It, who cares if they touch? You count that. If someone kicks a last second goal, who cares? You give them the goal.
100%. They had, Long in the grand final running from 50, kicked it, and they could have swore they touched it on the line back in 93, called it a goal because it was fun. Now we don't have any of that anymore. But I will say my boy, Horn Francis, Dangerfield comparison last weekend.
Here we go.
Dangerfield comparison this weekend. Same guy.
Two socks up still?
I reckon Danger's just got a mullet and he goes back to Adelaide on the weekends and he plays the game for Port. This was in Perth, so might have to tinker with that theory a little bit, but just bust out of the pack, kicks goals on the run. He can do it all. But yeah, Freo, competitive. Kind of like their season.
Yeah.
Not really there, but, you know, I think it was a good hit out for Port going into final.
You want to know what the best part of this game was?
What?
Freo's retro kick.
Yeah, it was sick. It's literally.
That was the biggest win for Freo on the day.
I think it's my favorite retro kit in the league. Mm. I mean, Collingwood have none.
The retro kit, it's the same thing. It's
a black and white.
Stripe.
We got the white and the black. We got black and white with a little pinstripe. Ooh. We got white and black with a black.
Oh, we've got the swoop jersey this year, though.
Yeah, but you don't even wear it.
Wear it. I'd be able to wear it, but
it would be cool. But
Eddie,
I just like
Eddie would lose his mind.
I just like the use of, like, obviously the anchor front and center, delicious. But I like the green.
Yeah,
because
no one uses
green
that color yet. It's kind of like piss yellow for Hawthorn.
It is like piss yellow for Hawthorn. I like that you said that.
We'll move into the last game, the Friday night thriller, Collingwood versus Brisbane, 1-2 at the beautiful, incredibly immaculate Marvel Stadium.
Now, you've already said that you're not saying stuff to piss off the AFL, but there was no tone to that. That was legitimate, and he loves Marvel Stadium. Did you hear Jack Riewoldt's comments about Marvel?
Geez, now that he's retired, he can say whatever the hell he wants.
And he did.
Yes!
In his last press conference, he's like, I'm going to miss so many things like Marvel Stadium. And then he laughed and said, nah, they can burn that joint to the ground.
Oh, damn, Jack.
That's coming in hot. Now, there's so many things coming out of this game. So we're gonna have to move our way through this. Yeah. But unfortunately, Collingwood couldn't get the job done over Brisbane. Now they're 0-2 against Brisbane, once up at the Gabba, now once at the spiritual home of football, Marvel Stadium. So, you know, but Collingwood had a fair few outs. No Dacos, no Dugowie, no Bobby, no
Darcy Moore.
Oh, yeah, I forgot him. He's a minor one.
Someone important somewhere.
So, you know, some outs. So I don't think most Collingwood fans or anything were, you know, sinking the ship, but it was, you'd like to get the win, obviously. But one thing that did come out of this.
What do you got for it?
Mason Cox, back in the AFL squad, named as a late sub.
Needed a bit of speed.
I do think that.
Inject that speed in the game, my brother.
Oh, we're looking a bit flat out there. Get Mason up. Get him warming up.
Super sub going.
So what was your week like? Because I had no idea. I was sitting there and I'm like, oh, who's the sub to my housemate? He's like, checks notes. Mason Cox. I was like, what the fuck?
So essentially it was talked about of me possibly being sub early in the week and then didn't really announce it until the day of. So you kind of prepped the game as per usual, as if you'd play, and was announced as the sub, which was, unique. Like, I wasn't quite sure. Like, I know I'd been playing well in the VFL, but you weren't really kind of sure what was going to, where the kind of dominoes were going to fall. But yeah, it was an interesting decision, I guess, to play a big man as a sub. Doesn't happen very often.
Always risky.
Always very risky. Last time I was a sub, I came in for Scott Pendlebury and played like absolute dog shit. So
the same speed.
Yeah, same speed. Fine wines. But that's kind of how it played
basketball
out. Basketball background. I don't know if you knew. Did you know that?
I did.
No? Did you know I'm American?
Oh, what? I thought he was American. I thought you were Australian.
Something like that. I don't know. But it was a unique week to play as a sub. It's always a different feelings. You know you're not going to start the game, but you might have to if someone goes down. And I had to go in, I think, at the very end of the third quarter. Jacob Ryan, unfortunately, on his debut game, ended up getting concussed.
Second quarter.
That's what I think. Yep. Into the second quarter. And very frustrating, you can imagine, for Jacob. Like, his whole family over there, like, friends, you have this incredible experience, you know, and once in a lifetime, you only debut once. And to go off with concussion, very, very frustrating, you just imagine. So as soon as he kind of went down, every time a player goes down, you kind of jump off the bench, start warming up. And that's kind of exactly what happened. And the physios came over to me and goes, look, he's concussed. We're going to assess him downstairs. We're pretty certain of this before he even goes down. So just be prepared to go on. So went in the second quarter and was able to play the rest of the game.
And play you did, Mace, because they threw you in the ruck, which, just a bit of a catch up for everyone not watching the VFL. Mace has had 100 hit outs in two games. Well, kind of two games. You played three quarters of the last one. Yeah. But threw you into the ruck, 25 hit outs in a half. So technically on track for a plumber.
It wasn't a half because there was, I did go into the second quarter, very into the second quarter. So
thanks
for the pop-up though. I appreciate that.
I'd give it, someone leave it in the chat if we give it to him. But a big game for a half in the ruck.
Yeah.
Got a fair amount of pump-up through the media, which is very rare. Silver service to the likes of Scott Pendlebury, who did end up getting, you know, 30-odd touches, kicked the goal.
He's our best player on the day for sure, yeah.
Yeah, so Pendle's, turning back the clock, but you just kept tapping it down to him. How did you feel out there back in the big time?
Yeah, it was good. It's nice to get back into the AFL and be able to play that. Like I said, being the sub was a unique experience. I hadn't done that in a long time, but I think we had the idea probably going in obviously covering Darcy Moore's injury, having Jeremy Howe on the forward line, like we could shift things around, move him into the back line if we needed to. We had kind of a few different options, right? Was able to go in and play mostly ruck. So won a few center bounces and kind of got, you know, pushed into there to stay there. And we kind of came back in the third for a little bit before kind of Brisbane took it away in the fourth. But it was a nice little run there. And, the likes of Scott Pendlebury just making you look good by making sure you get to the right spot at the right time definitely helps.
Now, there was a moment because the big fella gets up and down the ground when you're the ruck. Defensive 50, Connor McKenna, one-on-one. He was just staring into the goggles of greatness.
Oh, man. You know, whenever you see someone that's about three times as fast as you and you're corralling them from 30 meters away, you're just like, please to God, kick the fucking ball.
Just buying time. Just, come on, team. Where are you?
Someone please help me. Oh, help, help, help. No, it was. He did get in like D50 and he was like, he like turned and he kind of looked at me. And that, you know, whenever someone looks at you and goes, oh, I've got you.
Crap. He knows.
And I'm gone. Oh, no, no, no. That's essentially what happened.
You're thinking in your head, hopefully word hasn't come back from Ireland.
Yeah. This 7-foot American is not very fast. And he took me out. Luckily, you know, I kind of got blocked and I could kind of take that as the reasoning I couldn't catch up to him. But he took me on, kicked it, and I think they got out of D50. But it was kind of one of those funny moments in the game where you kind of look at it and you're like, it's like me, like today in training, we had a tackling drill and I'm going against Bobby Hill. And I'm like, I mean, come on. Like, realistically, this is not a great matchup. He took me on. It was pretty funny. That was something out of the game. But another few things, a few kind of little injuries. So Archie, he fell on his back taking a mark and felt it for the rest of the game. I think he came off towards the end and that looked right on the sacrum, like real just vulnerable position.
Yeah.
Going out for the mark and coming back on his back.
He looks stiff. Murph. It was kind of that tunneling motion, but one of those ones that was like completely incidental.
By the way, what happened to tunneling? Just doesn't get called nowadays.
Yeah, and there was a lot of it on the weekend.
Yeah. Very interesting how that changed. I don't know. Just a bit of advice. But Nathan Murphy, obviously, a few cork legs came off. Jacob Ryan, like we said, with concussion. So there's a few little things.
Bo's going to miss.
Bo got suspended for a game, I think it was, for a dangerous tackle. So he might miss a game, the last game of the season, and should be back for finals. Some other stuff out of this. John Noble, insane goal. I don't know if you saw that.
He did like a pirouette.
Spin pirouette ballerina, just let me dart one from 45 inside.
I think, there's going to be so many offended Collingwood players out there.
This would be good.
But I reckon he's in my top three favorites out there.
Yep.
And then I've probably got.
Is it because he was like a mid-season draft?
Yeah.
And just as like really had to work for a spot.
Yeah, I like those nuggets that try real hard.
Yeah.
I probably have Braden Maynard in there for number two because same name. Just like we go about it the same. Like we're both tough nuts.
You just want to beat the living shit out of the people everywhere.
Both leadership material, handsome, really well spoken.
It's getting real quiet in here.
I'll just leave the number one spot open.
Yeah, okay. Dorsey Moore. So anyway, another one. I don't know if you saw this. Eddie Betts, Nev Jetta had a little box up there with this guy.
Some guy
named Luke Combs. Luke Combs is, if anyone out there doesn't know who that is, he's one of the most famous country music stars out there at the moment. And he was at the game, which was cool. And I always find it funny because like anytime someone who's internationally known goes to an AFL game or Jack Harlow wears a Fremantle hat, the AFL loses its shit.
Yeah.
And they are just all over it. They're like, how can we leverage this man's popularity to get the rest of the world to give a shit about our sport? And they did that on the night.
Well, they kind of did. But first time the camera went up there, they were like, oh, there's Eddie Betts. And like, oh my God, it's Eddie Betts. And yeah, they didn't realize who they were sitting through. I have to admit, I have no idea who it is.
He's massive.
But I can imagine you're a big country western fan with your big Texas belt buckle and your cowboy hat and boots.
You best boy.
So you went to his concert, was it?
Went to the concert on Saturday night. Very good.
Favorite song?
Favorite song, Fast Cars. It's his most popular.
I feel like everyone's done a version of Fast Car.
Yeah, well, it's not actually his song. It's his most popular song. But I did sit next to Nico Hines, the NRL player.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, absolute legend. Nicest guy you ever meet. Now, I did realize this is one of the biggest difference between AFL and NRL.
No one knew who he was?
People knew who he was, like rolling around. Nico went up on stage and shotgunned a beer with Luke Combs.
Oh, yeah.
Can you imagine if an AFL player did that? No. Melbourne would lose its shit. Would just say, that is not acceptable in our community.
It's still on brand for them. Like, they like openly accept that.
And they're cool with it.
Yeah. I feel like AFL players do it. They just,
it's not public, maybe.
They don't pump it up.
Yeah. NRL's like, this is our identity.
If Taylor Swift comes to Melbourne,
yep.
It's like, Mason Cox, yes.
One,
spotlight
yes,
comes down. She's like, come up here and do a shoey with me.
100%. Without a question.
Don't care.
I will take all the consequences that come with that for that life moment.
Grand final week?
Yep. Still doing it. And I'll do a boot. I won't just do a shoe.
It's your version of Jack Rewalt's. It's like Mr. Brightside.
It is. Taylor Swift performed in the grand final.
And then what are you singing?
It'd be awesome. What am I singing?
Karma?
Karma's really good. Cruel Summer's elite too.
But they're just hot that's now. Fine. What do you do? Like a throwback to like one of the OGs?
Teardrops on my guitar, but that's not really a pump-up song. That's a real
depressing
song.
What's the duet one where the film clip is like the dudes in like the...
Which album? Folklore?
I don't know the album names. But like he's got the sign in his house across the road and they're like the neighbors next door and they're like flirting with each other. You could like do that,
like
play
the girl
that
next
out.
Door with her. Maybe I'll make I Am on the Floor. And I assume I'll be head above shoulders of everyone else. So
you got to do something to get attention.
Yeah, maybe we leave this in the comments, everyone. What can I do to get Taylor Swift's attention to get her bracelet on the day?
Yeah. You got to have is a sign a bit much?
Is she into tall guys? She's pretty tall.
Yeah. You have said tall girls gravitate to tall guys.
True. It's a proven fact. I've done the R&D.
She could write a song after you.
Jeez. That would be like, you know... It'd be like, why am I blanking on rolling in the deep?
Adele.
Adele. Yeah. It'd be like essentially Adele. Every time she gets in a relationship and breaks up with someone, she writes a fire album, an absolutely insanely good album.
Or you could just say it's like Taylor Swift because she does exactly that after she breaks up with everyone.
Well, we just went from a footy podcast to an entertainment podcast real quick. And we're going to go back to the football. Now, this week, what are we looking forward to?
Well, I just want to say I'm looking forward to it wrapping up now. Like after that Adelaide-Sydney result, and we'll look ahead for the games, but it really just kind of ruined the last round. So let's get that done.
Yeah.
Because then we have a week off. The women's game starts.
Yep.
I was driving in here yesterday, coffee. Sun was hitting the window in my car. You know, even if it's a little colder outside, but you're sitting in your car and the sun's coming through the window and it's like, feels warm. You can feel it on your skin. And I looked ahead in the app at the weather. We got like 18, 18, 18, all sunny. I mean, nice? Anyone that doesn't live in Victoria is laughing at us right now.
Dude, idiots. Why would you ever choose to live there?
But 18 and sunny, I'll take that every day of the week. Start cracking beers outside. Sun stays up a little longer. Yeah. Barbecue starts rolling out of the covers. Yeah, I'm just looking forward to finals footy.
Hypothetically, if you had to pick a favorite beer, what would it be?
Do we have a sponsor?
Carlton Draft, I think.
Is yeah, what love boy. To have,
right? I don't know if they're – we're throwing it out there. You know what? Fuck it. Tag Carlton Draft below. That's what we need. We need to put pressure on the sponsors. Let's reverse psychology this shit.
Carlton
Zeros. I'll do the zeros. Yeah. You do the full strengths.
If we can get a beer sponsor going into finals, that will save me so much money. Because I really ramp up come finals time and the sun's coming out.
Cash and product.
What are you looking for?
Friday night. I mean, like, we went on this whole Sunday, you know, games, all that kind of stuff. But the Friday night MCG, last game of the season, Essendon Collingwood, big rivalry. Like, this is why you play. Like,
it's still going to be big. And they always get up for, like, you. It's like West Coast always gets up for Collingwood. Essendon, Carlton, the Tigs, they always get up for Collingwood. And it's going to be...
Got a target on our back all year, you know, but it'll be a good game. I'm assuming a massive crowd as per usual, and good to be playing back at the MCG.
Even if it's not a massive crowd, because Essendon's just, you know, packed her up and gone on postseason trip, Collingwood's going to rock up. Collingwood fans, last chance to get a taste of it before finals, and tickets get a little harder to come by. But yeah, get out there Friday night footy, heading into finals.
And we're going to do shout outs. What's your shout out?
Well, I just want to.
Feeling I know you would.
I just want to say, just GWS in general. Just
the big sound. The big sound.
Just the vibe of the whole thing.
From the west of the town.
Just the fact that they're kind of propping up the last round because it's the last game of the last round. All comes down to them. If Bulldogs get the W over the Cats, down at the Cattery. GWS need to win to make finals. So it gives that last game a bit of spice.
Yeah.
But then, yeah, everything in general. GWS just been good little battlers this year because no one expected anything from them.
No.
And everyone was like, Toby, why don't you move away? Like, sticking it out with this team. It's like, well, now who's laughing? He's going to be All-Australian captain. And
when you said this before, I can't wait for that smirk on his face.
And he's going to take his team to finals.
That is so good. I want to give a little shout out to Lionel Messi. That man is bringing soccer back to America. He's making soccer great again.
It is good to see.
I feel like every time I flick my phone on, he's got some other highlight reel from the game. Every single game he plays, he just kicks like a ridiculous set shot or like a ridiculous free kick, we're going to call it. And
they don't take set shots. Yeah, the set play.
I've been transferred over to Australia now. And he's just killing it. And it's cool to see like U.S. soccer, because growing up, like soccer in the U.S. was not that big. And it is blown up. You had the David Beckham came over. Thierry Henry came over and played for the New York team. And now Messi's playing for Miami. And it's just great to see these big names coming over and making soccer big back home.
Wouldn't be a hard sell, would it? They're like, come over here, we'll give you hundreds of millions, we'll give you part ownership in the team.
That's the big part.
And you get to live in Miami.
Yep.
Okay.
Where no one probably knows who you are.
And you get to play, but essentially for you, it would be like playing like Div 4 Rezzies.
It'd be like that guy last week that kicked 41 goals in a game.
Yeah. He just, no wonder he's got a new highlight every week. He just gets to go out there and play against another level.
Yeah. All right. Now, before we get into the games to watch out for this week, I want to make mention of this because it was big news over the weekend. Jack Zeeble obviously played his last game, probably out for a drink, you could possibly say, after at the Osborne, and essentially was king hit, really, outside of this establishment, and now has had some serious damage done to him. And we just want to first of all say prayers up to Jack. Like, hopefully, you know, you get better, mate. It's ridiculous, Steve. And I don't know the situation, what happened or anything like that, but it's ridiculous to think that this is this outcome of something, whatever it may be. And I feel for him on a night that he's probably wanting to be a memorable one where he gets to enjoy himself. This now is a situation that's turned into something bigger. It really just shit, man. I'm trying to put this in a nice way. Yeah. Like, it really grinds my gears, like, to a ridiculous point. But it's just unnecessary. And it's such a thing here, I feel like. I don't know. I didn't really see this as much back home, but There just seems to be an aggression with people whenever they drink. And if that is the case with any of your friends, remove them from the scenario and tell them to go home. There's no need for them to be in a public environment if they're one of those rage machines. And we all know that person that does get a bit drunk and does get a bit physical, whatever it is. Take them home. Tell them to go to sleep.
Yeah, he wanted to celebrate his career and move on with the rest of his life. Now that's kind of stalled a bit with this. He's got to go through hospital. He's got to get facial surgery. So yeah, it kind of puts the brakes on that for a bit. But prayers up to Jack Zabel. Yeah, no one deserves to get king hit.
No.
But yeah, there's
that much education around it nowadays.
I don't get like, violence in like any way, shape or form, but yeah.
Anyway, we'll get into just had to cover that, but wanted to get into the games to watch out for this week. Obviously, the last round of the season, 24 rounds we have now?
24 rounds, which we do have, but you only play 23 because you got the bye. Collingwood can lock away a top spot if they beat Essendon Friday night. North v Suns in Tassie. We already talked about that one, but I think I'm just getting a call in now. If you get on the website now, I think there's a couple of tickets left that you can pick up for that one. Surely there's going to be 30, 40 people there.
Wow.
Well, I can't imagine. What are you going for?
Quack.
Why are you rocking up?
Just to see AFL, mate. You live in town.
Even Tassie people are like, yeah, they've come down a couple of times. We saw them. We saw them.
Brutal.
Well, what are they going to... Oh, it's the first time we can see the Suns
move
in ages.
Move on.
Brizzy v. the Saints at the Gabba. Yep. Saints on an absolute heater. So not really sure what comes of that. Like Brizzy can lock in that top two. Which,
I think momentum is the biggest thing that's coming out of that for either team.
Yeah, and man, Brisbane top two finish. I reckon it almost guarantees them a grand final spot.
Home, fortress. We've talked about many times on this podcast that don't lose a home.
Go Gabba, MCG, and then it's whether they can get it done on the MCG. Bulldogs v. Cats, the only real game that can cause some turbulence.
Shift.
So if Bulldogs win, they are in the top eight, and then it comes down to GWS v. Carlton. GWS need to win to then make finals. If Bulldogs lose that, GWS are in, my boys. And Sydney v. Melbourne at the SCG.
That'll be good. I think that's the game of the round.
Good game. Ice. But it's just what they're doing, like what they're playing for. As you said, momentum, but it's not really like a position thing or anything.
I think it's just two good teams going at it in Sydney. Melbourne's obviously ahead of them on the ladder. But Sydney now making finals, like they'll be wanting to make a bit of a statement before they go into it. So, there could be two Sydney teams in the eight this year, which is quite interesting. And who said expansion's not good for the game?
It looks like probably it'll be Carlton GWS first week of finals.
Yeah,
again.
Which so, is double up.
So
two times in 3 weeks.
If that is the case, they're going to have a lot of intel on each other. So then it's like...
Show your cards.
But yeah, you kind of have to wait for that Bulldogs Geelong game to play out first before you start playing a bit of poker.
Very true. Very true. Well, it's going to be a great week of football. We're excited. We're getting to the end of the season. We're wrapping up this season.
Mason Cox starts to shine coming into the big games.
Knock on wood, please. But it is going to be an exciting month ahead. Jump on board. Tell your friends everything else because we're going to do some exciting stuff too. And we're going to obviously be pumping out these podcast episodes. Are going to be good fun.
And go get a ticket to Beyond the Valley because we're...
Yeah, BTV.
As someone told you, we're playing at Beyond the Valley.
BTW, we're going to BTV.
Can you say we're playing at Beyond the Valley? Because then it makes it sound like we're in a band.
Is Rufus behind us, I think? Are they? No, they'd be prequel to us, sure.
I reckon the rumor has it that we're opening for the DMAs.
Huge. I don't know who the DMAs are, but
go, you'll be
they sound like a great... band, great people.
Luke Combs stage.
Yep, the Luke Combs. Well, I just want to mention this again. Devin Robinson, well done. Start the OnlyFans, mate. It's the time. Strike while the iron's hot, you half-naked human. But
he's got a fast car. I got a ticket to get us out of here and work at a convenience store.
That's pretty close. Yeah, that's pretty good. Well done. We're going to end on that, though.
I got a ticket to get us to Blundstone Arena. I'm going to watch the Suns.
Take on the mighty kangaroos. All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for listening in. As mentioned, follow us on all the socials and everything else. Put some stuff together and leave us some comments on the things we talked about in the podcast. We're very excited to be part of Beyond the Valley. Thank you so much to everyone, the organizers there, and we will hopefully see some of our fans there. And it's going to be an incredible month ahead of us. So make sure you're tuned in, subscribed, and everything else. But that is it from us. Another week done.
See ya.
See ya.